The president has made it very clear that he would like to have a bipartisan resolution of this. He says that, knowing full well as I do, that the 14th Amendment is still there, and as president of the United States, he has some authority to use it.
That's not really, it's not really how that works. We talked about that yesterday. That was James Clyburn discussing one of the tactics that Democrats are flirting around with in order to get what they would like for this debt ceiling debacle. Welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. You can listen to the radio program from coast to coast. You can also stream it, and you can watch the simulcast of the program as well. YouTube, Facebook, Channel 347, DirecTV. That would be one of the worst solutions to this crisis I can imagine. And on this issue, plus the Durham Report, as well as the FBI inflating some numbers for domestic terrorism, we go to our very good friend, Andy McCarthy, bestselling author. He's also one of the bylines at National Review, contributing editor. And you can watch him on Fox News. And he's former chief assistant U.S. attorney. And you might remember the book that he had, Ball of Collusion. Great book. You should have it. Andy, always so good to have you. I just kind of have to get your legal eagle response to James Clyburn pushing this, because you would think with some other Democrats not on board and people like Janet Yellen even warning that this is not the best idea and it could have some catastrophic consequences, that they would maybe back away from this a little bit, but not yet, it seems.
Yeah, well, Dana, I think they're out there using this rhetorically as a negotiation tactic. I don't think anybody really believes this is true. Even Biden and Yellen the last 2 days, feinting that they, you know, had this authority, also said, but, you know, there isn't time for us to invoke it at this point anyway. And it's so patently illegal. I mean, they keep saying that the spending is authorized by law and therefore we have to pay it. And I keep wondering, isn't the debt ceiling authorized by law?
Right.
In fact, the last time it was authorized by law, it was signed into law by none other than Joe Biden.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't recall him making the slightest peep that it might be unconstitutional. So I'm a little bit puzzled about how it's not a law that he's taken a constitutional oath to enforce faithfully, which is a lot more than you can say for spending, especially if Congress hasn't upped the government's credit card. Which is what it takes to authorize spending when you have a deficit. But I guess, you know, all these legal questions are very interesting to people like me for, like, you know, law school exams and stuff like this. I have a practical question. Who's going to buy the Biden bonds? You know, let's say they do it. Who is going to buy a bond that hasn't been authorized by Congress?
That's the million-dollar question. I don't know who would.
Well, it's actually the $31.4 trillion question. But who, if they're not getting, if no one would buy these, then what's the point? What are we arguing about? You know, it's just like it's another iteration of our unseriousness. I mean, it's moronic to think anyone would even think about buying this.
It seems as though a desperate move, because they realize, you know, especially after a bill passed the House, and, you know, they got to come to the table and have the discussion about it. It just seems really like a last ditch effort to try to not negotiate. That's the only thing that I can think of. Of course, you know, abusing authority, whether it's through the CDC or anything else, hasn't gone well with them, or well for them, I should say. Speaking of which, abusing authority, I wanted to ask you about, and we're going to get into the Durham Report. This kind of goes into it. People are very suspicious and distrustful of our agencies, particularly the FBI. And you have a great piece just outright called Democrats Cook the FBI's Books on Domestic Terrorism. I know that you had gotten into this before. You wrote, I think, a couple of years ago, another piece similar to this. And you were explaining, and this is going along with the House Oversight Committee and Jim Jordan and others who have pointed out that, you know, there's after all of the discussion from the Biden administration about the biggest threats of, you know, of terrorism against, you know, the here in the country. Now we have this question of whether or not some of these numbers were actually authentic or whether they were inflated for the purpose of this narrative. I don't even know how this goes, Andy, as long as how it takes place as long as it has without it being caught or or any accountability. I mean, I don't really have any words. I just continually am shocked by what's coming out of this bureau.
Yeah, I think part of it, Dana, is that it is so shocking that people, you know, when you first hear it, you act like I acted when I was when it was first suggested to me that the Bureau would take a screed of opposition research that it hadn't corroborated, slap a caption on it, and swear to it under oath in the FISA court. When I first heard that, I said that was the kookiest thing I ever heard, and that the people who were saying it would end up, you know, looking like the tinfoil hat crowd, and turned out it was completely right. So a lot of this stuff is just, I think it defies what we think are the lowest levels of outrageous behavior that they would engage in. But what they have been doing, and they really started this before the Capitol riot, was to try to change the definition in federal law of what domestic terrorism is, to actually insulate and undercount things like jihadism and other, you know, left-wing uses of force, and home in only on white supremacism, order the FBI and the Homeland Security Department to ratchet up their investigations of white supremacy on the notion that it was the equivalent of what is domestic terrorism as the United States threat environment exists today. And then what we saw in this hearing last week, where the whistleblowers testified, is that they're inflating the numbers. And just to make people understand how this works, when I ran the Blind Shay case back in the 90s, it was a 3-year investigation, right? We ran it out of one FBI office in New York. And what typically happens in a long investigation is you send out leads if you have a case where there's evidence or witnesses or what have you in other districts around the country. And then the agents in those districts follow up the leads, and everything gets forwarded back to the one place where the case is taking place. What they've done with the Capitol riot is it's located in the Washington field office of the FBI because it's being prosecuted in the District of Columbia. But instead of just sending out leads, they're sending out directives to other FBI offices around the country to open cases. So that what happens is, because they have like 49 different states that have some people came to the Capitol that day, they now say they have domestic terrorism cases in 49 states. So, for example, January 6th, you take a bus from, say, Minnesota to Washington and, you know, amble through the Capitol, not breaking a window, not hitting a police officer, but like you have your selfie out, you're walking through the Capitol, you're in there for, you know, 10 minutes and then out. They have a domestic terrorism case in Minnesota on you, even if in Washington you've only been charged with loitering or some other
that's
misdemeanor.
That's crazy.
So that's what they're doing. And they're telling everyone that this goes to the Democratic narrative that white supremacism, which is their code for, you know, basically Trump voters, are the biggest threat to national security and to our democracy. And they're pushing the FBI to try to underwrite that claim by the way it keeps its books. And now I think, Dana, that it's even worse than what I wrote the other day, because we just got a report from the FISA court about these 280,000 communications that they shouldn't have access, but they did access. When you read the opinion from the FISA court, it looks like the thing that most drove that was the Capitol riot. So I think they're even using FISA to try to push this narrative. It's unbelievable.
Wow. And the fact that they had to inflate it, the fact that there wasn't enough and they had to reclassify cases because the Bureau wasn't finding enough. I mean, that alone should tell you, then it's not actually a big threat if they're having to manufacture cases.
Yeah, well, when I was doing jihadist cases in the 90s, you could tell that we actually had jihadist cases because every now and then you'd hear like, and people would die.
Yes.
You know? That was not something that was manufactured. It was something that you needed only open your eyes to see that it was there. And they didn't want to see.
Yeah.
But this isn't there, so they need to invent it.
We're talking with our friend Andy McCarthy, his book, Ball of Collusion. This Durham Report, I've been just chomping at the bit to ask you about this, and you've written some really great pieces about this, analysis of this. One of the things that really, because I read the Durham Report, and I think it was, I can't remember if it was like page 101 or 102, but the two, they had this excerpt of these two agents. One was, I guess, the case agent for Crossfire Hurricane, and the other was also within the FBI, but on a different specialty, different task. And they were having a discussion about whether or not they could trust the sourcing for what they were looking at, whether or not they could trust what the sourcing was. And they actually cited the fact that, well, these news reports out, the news reports that was based on, as you said, the discredited, unvalidated, and unverified by the FBI oppo that Hillary Clinton and the DNC, their campaigns, paid for, that was being presented to these FBI agents without even them knowing, which kind of gets into how there's this huge gap between the rank and file and the leadership and really purpose, a gap of, for the lack of a better way to put it, purpose, where leadership looks like they're weaponizing and politicizing this office. And then you have rank and file that, you know, they were trying to do their due diligence, but they were only given oppo research that had been laundered through the press so as to present some sort of, you know, evidentiary, some basis through which to get this FISA warrant. I wanted to get your kind of thoughts on this and what that means really for the future of the Bureau, because I can't imagine, if we don't have any trust in the Bureau, I can only imagine what some of the rank and file agents on the ground, what they think of their superiors.
Yeah, I think that's right. And look, this FISA report that we've just gotten isn't going to make that any better. You would never, Dana, in any other context except here where headquarters was running an investigation, can you imagine you have a case where you have FBI agents, let's say, who investigate the mafia or right. some organized crime thing. Can you imagine that two of them sitting around saying, gee, I wish we could trust the sourcing. I wish we could talk to a witness maybe and see if this really, that would never happen, right? But the thing is, these agents who are professional investigators felt that they were not in a position to do this because this investigation was taken over by headquarters. So this, as somebody said the other day, I think this was the best analogy of it, this train was coming down the track. Mm-hmm. So their job was to get out of the way because they were powerless to do anything other than complain about it. And I actually feel good about the fact that there were so many good, decent, hardworking agents who just said, this ain't right. This is just is wrong from soup to nuts. And it was.
So where would the accountability be for this? Because I know you had said that it doesn't necessarily violate a criminal statute. It doesn't meet that measure. But where, because everyone else is like, well, if they can get away with that, what can't they not get away with? So where would the accountability fall?
Yeah, what I think Chris Ray would say about that, not that he's the most credible guy right now, but I think what he would say and what he has said is that you may notice that none of the people who were running this investigation work here anymore, that they've drummed them out and they've made changes. The problem is they drummed them out really quietly because the Bureau is, of all the agencies in government, I've always thought the FBI was the most self-conscious about its reputation. Mm. So when it should have tried to show people that it was cleaning house and getting serious about doing things the right way, they instead quietly kind of pushed everyone out. So the public isn't moved by that because they see these guys are on CNN and with book contracts and all this. They've failed up, right? So it's not like they've been held accountable. And then the other thing Ray says is we've changed a lot of the procedures since then. And that sounds good. And they have changed some procedures. But I have to say, When I was a prosecutor, and this is now, I left 20 years ago, but still, you know, these procedures that they've changed now weren't in effect. I never met an agent who didn't know that you're not supposed to bring to a court raw intelligence that you haven't corroborated and swear to the truth of it when you had reason to believe it wasn't accurate. So, like, what training made them think that was okay?
Yeah,
I never met an agent in 20 years who thought it was okay to bring inaccurate information to a court that you hadn't investigated.
That's unbelievable. Well, I mean, I feel like this is going to continue unfolding for quite some time. Our friend Andy McCarthy, his book, Ball of Collusion, The Plot to Rig an Election and Destroy a Presidency. As always, Andy, we so appreciate your insight. Thank you so much for your time, my friend. Good to talk with you.
Thanks, Dana.
Of course.